It's a great day for baseball. It's a great day for a doubleheader, and that's exactly what we got planned for you next, right here on the campus of Centenary College of Louisiana, some NCAA Division III baseball. Today, from Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport, Louisiana, the gents meet the Laterno Yellow Jackets. Great to be back with you again, everybody. Pierre Baida alongside Preston Ludwig. And Preston, it's finally here, the final midweek non-conference game of the Gen schedule.
Yeah, it kind of feels surreal. This season's kind of flown by pretty fast. Matter of fact, this whole school year has flown by really fast. So it's kind of a sad time to kind of sit back and watch the Gens play some baseball here at Sheehy. But it should be a good two-game set here tonight.
The thing I like most about these midweek non-conference games, at this point in the season especially, is I kind of divide the Gen schedule into three different sections. You got the early non-conference games. I kind of liken that to Major League spring training. Guys are building up their pitch counts, getting their feet under them. Some guys are still battling for roster spots or spots in the starting lineup. And then, of course, you got the games that matter most, the conference games, the games the Gens have been playing lately, the ones that are make and break your ticket to Cleburne for the playoffs. But these games are often forgotten about, the games after the conference schedule starts that are still non-conference, so they don't really have any bearing on your playoff push, but I still think they're important, especially for guys like Zach Malone, who are going to get a start today. Mike Diaz will never throw one of his big three in the rotation for these non-conference games, so it's a great opportunity for some of the other guys who aren't in the rotation to, you know, say, hey, I'm capable of getting outs here at the varsity level in college, and that's what Zach Malone's going to set out to do.
Absolutely. I mean, I was just about to say, I was able to talk to head coach Mike Diaz for the Gents during BP today, and he said the same exact thing. These are the games that are meant for the guys that are trying to get into the rotation. Obviously, you're going to have your starters in, your starting nine that are your regulars, but these are the games meant for guys that are kind of on the edge of whether or not they are supposed to be the starters for the Gents or not. And so this will be a good time for some of those pitchers that are on the cusp of being in the rotation on a regular basis, as well as some of the batters that are new in the lineup.
Yeah, and these two teams were supposed to play last Tuesday in Longview. That game was rained out, so we play 2 7-inning games today. Last time these two clubs met was last year, March 28th, right here at Sheehy Stadium. And it was a game that you may remember. It was on the heels of the University of Dallas brouhaha. So a lot of Gents were suspended for that game. They were serving their suspensions for that game. So a lot of the starting nine were not in that lineup. But one guy who was Cody Myers, who got the start in both games, in fact, last season against the Yellow Jackets. And look at what he's blossomed into this season. He pitched 6 innings last year at the home game against Laterno, and he's turned into the Gents' number one. So, I mean, these games are invaluable for guys who are looking on the outside looking in, especially for that pitching rotation. That game, you may remember, was actually a ninth-inning walk-off sacrifice fly by Gary Hewitt. One of his final great moments in his five-year career with the Diamond Gents, a walk-off sac fly in the ninth that scored Caleb Ickes from third, and that weird lineup that Mike Diaz put out last season. So why don't we take a look at the starting lineup. First for the visiting Laterno Yellow Jackets, they're sending their DH Hayden Norris in the leadoff spot to be followed by the first baseman Xander Neighbors. Then the third baseman Kevin Soto, the cleanup hitter is the catcher Jagger Vaughn. Cade Hathorn bats fifth and plays right field, followed by the left fielder Dylan Cortez. Shortstop Tyler Heaton bats seventh. He'll be followed by the second baseman Ethan Wood, and Zach Zarco plays center field and rounds out the Yellow Jackets lineup coached by Paul Phillips. For Mike Diaz's Gents, who come in with a record of 16-11, they send the left fielder Carson Olivese to lead off for them, followed by the third baseman Clay Menard. Alex Miller bats third and plays first, followed by the cleanup hitting right fielder Austin Benoit. Shortstop Joby Boone bats fifth, and he'll be followed by the second baseman Miles Keith. Then the center fielder Colin Pitts batting eighth and catching is Jake Gauntz, and the DH Gage Morris bats ninth with the aforementioned Zachary Malone on the mound for the Gents. Well, we got first pitch coming up in about 10 minutes or so from Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport. It's the Yellow Jackets and the Gents coming your way next. Stay tuned. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to CD Stadium for today's non-conference doubleheader matchup between the Laverno University Yellow Jackets and your Centenary Gems. Here are today's starting lineups, first for visiting Laverno. Leading off, the designated hitter, number 10, Hayden Norris. And second and playing first base, number 13, Xander Neighbors. Batting third and playing third base, number 25, Kevin Soto. Batting fourth and batting, number 15, Jagger Vaughn. Batting fifth and playing right field, number 18, Cade Hathor. Batting sixth and playing left field, number 22, Dylan Cortez. Batting seventh and playing shortstop, number 26, Tyler. Thank you.
lineup for your Cincinnati Gens. Leading off and playing left field, a sophomore from Lafayette, Louisiana, number 27, Carson Livesay. Batting second and playing third base, a sophomore from Berwyn, Louisiana, number 6, Clay Bernard. Batting third and playing first base, a freshman from Cypress, Texas, number 40, Alex Miller. Batting fourth and playing right field, a senior from Welsh, Louisiana, number 12, Austin Zenwa. Batting fifth and playing shortstop, a junior from Opelousas, Louisiana, number 2, Toby Boo. Batting sixth and playing second base, a freshman from Lindale, Texas, number 31, Miles Key. Batting seventh and playing center field, a sophomore from Lufkin, Texas, number 25, Colin Pitt. Batting eighth and catching, a senior from Katy, Texas, number 24, Jake Goss. Batting ninth, the designated hitter, a freshman from Livingston, Texas, number 14, Gage Morris. And the starting pitcher, a junior from Hallsville, Texas, number 30, Zachary Malone. Secondary is coached by Mike Diaz. He's assisted by Cody Crowder, Chris Zapata, and Tyler Wells. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please rise and remove your caps as we honor America with the playing of our national anthem.
Welcome back to Sheehy Stadium, just about ready to get underway. Yellow Jackets and the Gents, 2 7-inning games today. Zachary Malone towing the rubber for the Diamond Gents. Let's take a look at the rest of the Gents defensively behind Malone, with Jake Gaunce doing the catching. Around the infield from left to right, it's Clay Menard at third, Joby Boone at short, Miles Keith at second, and Alex Miller at first. And around the outfield from left to right, it's Carson Livesay in left, Colin Pitts in center, and Austin Benoit in right. Top third of the Yellow Jackets order will be Hayden Norris, Xander Neighbors, and Kevin Soto to greet the Gents right-hander. Malone, a junior out of Hallsville, Texas, getting the start in this first of two non-conference meetings between these two D3 clubs. We thank you for spending part of your Tuesday afternoon with us. Cloudy day here in Shreveport, just after 3 o'clock. Pretty hot though, 82 degrees, and that's without the sun.
It's always humid here in Shreveport. Can't escape it.
Well, Hayden Norris striding to the dish, and we're just about ready to get going.
Leading off from Paterno, designated hitter, number 10, Hayden Norris.
Zachary Malone working from the stretch. Deals the game's first pitch. It's swung on in line to center. Pitts barely has to move. He reaches up, makes the grab, and that's how we get underway today.
Batting second, first baseman, number 13, Xander Neighbors.
So here's Xander Neighbors. The Letourneau first baseman, right-handed hitter. The pitch from Malone, he squares around and pulls the bat back. And the pitch is a called strike, nothing and one. A one pitch just misses off the outer edge, and the count evens at 1-1. Neighbors, a junior out of Conroe, Texas. Lifted, shallow right center, Pitts. Ranging to his left, he'll be called off by Benoit, who makes a nice leaping grab. And so Neighbors flies out for out number two.
And third baseman, number 25, Kevin Soto.
That'll bring up the third baseman, Kevin Soto. First pitch swinging, he fouls it back to the backstop, 0-1.
Zachary Malone, the pitcher for the Gents today. 12 appearances on the year, started one. He's got a 3-0 record with a 5.01 ERA, and he's one of those guys that I was talking to Diaz before the game. He's going to be one of those guys that, you know, needs to get in and get some innings under his belt, especially after coming off a week at St. Thomas where he only threw one inning, I think one inning and a third. And so he's kind of one of the players that's going to get in the mix and just try and get some work. And he's one of those guys that's going to throw strikes. And that's why Mike Diaz threw him out there today. And he said, hey, give us one or two innings. If you go three or four, great.
And there's a swing and a miss. So a good start for Zachary Malone. He picks up his first strikeout and issues a 1-2-3 top half of the first inning. We'll head to the home half. It's the Yellow Jackets nothing. Gents coming to bat. Nothing-nothing game as we begin the bottom half of the first inning. Riley Davis, the Yellow Jackets left-hander, lines and deals his first pitch, and it's a called strike one on Carson Livesay, the Gents left fielder. Livesay, Menard, and Miller, top third of the Centenary lineup. Next pitch, misses just outside. A ball and a strike. First two men to greet Davis here in the home half are left-handed hitters, Livesay and Menard. As Livesay takes a pitch, just misses high, and it's 2-1. Up and in, and a good hitter's count for Livesay, ahead in the count, 3-1. The sophomore from Lafayette, Louisiana, awaits the next pitch, and it's outside, ball four. So the Gents have their leadoff runner aboard.
Batting second, third baseman, number 6, Clay Menard.
In steps the Berwick native Clay Menard. Neighbors holding the runner at first. The pitch is upstairs for ball one. Outside, and Menard ahead in the count, 2 balls and no strikes. Gents have been playing good baseball lately. They took 2 of 3 from St. Thomas over the weekend to keep pace with the Trinity Tigers. They're still looking up at them, half game behind Trinity for the SCAC top spot in the conference. As Menard turns and got a piece of him. So Clay Menard aboard via the hit by pitch, and the Gents have 2 on for their number 3 hitter, Alex Miller.
Third, first baseman, number 40, Alex Miller.
Trinity took 2 of 3 from Texas Lutheran, by the way, over the weekend. First pitch to Miller is a called strike. So normally the Gents play, well, let me put it this way, they look forward to playing at a professional field every May, the Depot at Cleburne Station. That's usually the top level of field that they play on, but they got a nice treat over the weekend when they got to play at Constellation Field in Sugar Land, Texas, in the greater Houston area, the AAA affiliate of the Houston Astros. The Space Cowboys now play there. So it was a nice treat for the Gents getting to play at a AAA ballpark over the weekend. Miller swings and grounds the 1-1 pitch, foul, wide of third, past head coach Mike Diaz doing the coaching in the third base box, with former Diamond Gent Chris Zapata doing the coaching on the other side of the diamond, past the first base bag.
Yeah, Pierre, going back to that point, I think some of my favorite memories as a baseball player was playing in those big stadiums. I remember specifically after my freshman year in the summer, I went up to Chillicothe, Missouri for a summer league.
As Miller pops it foul, it's going to get out of play right side.
And we actually took a trip over to St. Joseph and played at an old minor league park there that they just used recreationally for some city games.
That's cool.
I can't remember exactly what the stadium was called, but I'm sure I could figure that out pretty quick for you. But I think I played in front of 4,000 people.
Wow.
And it was just a summer league game. So... Pretty cool experience.
Yeah.
And then obviously playing at the Depot is always a joy every single year.
Yeah. Depot, a great facility. Gents trying to get their way back to Cleburne in a few weeks. Two of the toughest weekends on their schedule coming up as Miller sends that one high in the air and deep to left. Going back, Cortez at the wall. And this one is gone. Alex Miller, a 3-run shot to left. And the Gents lead 3-0. I thought Cortez might have had a play on that the way he was looking back at it, but turned and looked up, and it was a bomb from Miller.
Yeah, off the bat, I thought that kind of got in on his hands, but what a good job staying through that ball and driving it
Batting fourth, right fielder, number 12, Austin Benoit.
Speaking of home runs, Austin Benoit, the batter now, had one this past weekend at Constellation Field. That one went about 414 feet, but it did get out of the stadium, out to left field.
Benoit's been swinging a great bat.
He has. He's got a 318 average on the year with 27 RBI.
Tells you about the strength of Alex Miller, how you said that, you know, it looked like he got jammed a little bit in on his hands and he was still able to muscle it out of here as Benoit ropes that one foul.
Yeah, I mean, the wind was howling earlier, but it's kind of calmed down a little bit. There's a tiny bit of a jet stream, but it's kind of pushing out towards center, right center field. So the fact that he was able to muscle that one out of here, really impressive.
Sky to center, Zarco to his left, approaching the track, reaches up and makes the catch, and that's the first out of the inning.
Batting fifth, shortstop, number 2, Joby Boo.
So here's Joby Boone. Gents lead 3-0 in the first. Takes a pitch upstairs for ball one. Pitch is in there, and it's 1-1. Line down the left field side. It's going to get down foul into the Gents' bullpen. So Centenary will travel and play Texas Lutheran on the road this coming weekend before returning home for senior weekend, last weekend of April, to host the Trinity Tigers. And those two series are really critical, not only for the Gents making the playoffs, but of course for seeding, who plays who. 1-2, in on his hands, fisted out to left, Cortez in, makes the grab.
Second baseman, number 31, Miles Keith.
So two outs now for the Gents. Second baseman, Miles Keith. Freshman takes a fastball for a called strike, 0-1. Inside, 1-1. Fouled off, 1-2. Gents wearing their two-tone white and maroon jersey tops with Gents block lettering across the chest, white pants and maroon caps with the block C. Yellow Jackets wearing the gold jersey tops and white pants and blue caps. As that pitch misses outside, 2-2. You know what I've noticed is that the Gents really haven't worn their maroon Gents script jerseys at home very much this season. They've been kind of rotating these jerseys with the black Centenary jerseys, and that's kind of become their primary road jersey whenever
yeah,
I watch them on the
during
road.
My time here, I mean, we used to love wearing that jersey at home. It was just a classic,
yeah.
And now it's just used as an away jersey.
Interesting. As Keith takes a fastball inside, he draws the two-out walk, and that keeps the inning alive for Colin Pitts.
Batting seventh, center fielder, number 25, Colin Pitts.
Pop foul. I know the Gents lost the finale against St. Thomas over the weekend, but what a great job by the Gents battling back in the ninth inning, down by 3 to tie it at 7, even force extra innings. I mean, the battling Gents of 2024.
Yeah, and I think one of the biggest things.
That's it pretty well to right, but in his tracks is Hathorn. He reaches up, makes the catch, and the inning is over. So Preston in the middle of a sentence yet again.
Yeah, I'll just continue that story next inning.
We'll go to the top of the second. A three-run bomb by Alex Miller has the gents up early. It's Centenary 3, Letourneau nothing.
Leading off for Letourneau, catcher number 15, Jagger Vaughn.
Jagger Vaughn leading off the top of the second inning for Letourneau. Malone from the stretch. First pitch is fouled sharply. It looked like it got a piece of the umpire and ricochets out of play. Part of the Letourneau order due up here in the second. Vaughn, Hathorn, and Cortez, 4, 5, and 6 against Zachary Malone. Next pitch, fouled off to the right, and quickly it's nothing and two. Chopper foul. So before you were so rudely interrupted by the inning break, you were saying, Preston?
Yeah, I was just saying that, you know, the Gents did come back from that three-run deficit against St. Thomas this past week in Game 3 and ended up losing in extras. But it's just been those games that have been the one-run games that we just can't seem to win. And I think a lot of it is bear down throughout the game up to that point. I mean, we were talking about Colin Pitts before the game started today, and he kind of favored his knee as he thought he had injured it during one of the games earlier in the series, and ultimately there was a routine ball, you know, coming in shallow center field, right center, and he couldn't make the play. And, you know, obviously that didn't lose the game for the Gents, but there were things building up to that point.
Batting fifth, right fielder, number 18, Cade Hathorn.
Yeah, and speaking of Colin Pitts, he just tried to make a spectacular play. Wasn't able to come up with it, however, so it's a leadoff double for Vaughn. First hit for the Yellow Jackets as they have a runner in scoring position for Cade Hathorn. The Yellow Jackets right fielder takes a pitch in the dirt. It's blocked by Gontz.
Gontz has done a great job behind the plate so far this season for the Gents.
Really has been paying attention in the Chris Zapata school of blocking. That one is hit high in the air, but going to get out of play. Well, foul over near Virginia's place, the concession stand, and beyond the right field wall.
And Gontz, not only a great blocker, but great arm. Able to gun guys down with ease at times.
Hathorn pops it up, left side, Menard in foul ground. Will make the catch. Gents third baseman puts that one away for out number one.
Batting six, left fielder, number 22, Dylan Cortez.
So in steps Dylan Cortez, the left fielder. One out, runner at second. Gents lead by three. The pitch from Malone in the dirt. Another great block by Gaunt. Just see it week after week. Gaunt's like a brick wall back there. And he catches every game. I mean, he really is the second coming of Chris Zapata, it seems. Maybe he won't hit 12 home runs like Zapata did in his
definitely not
2017 campaign, but defensively at least, a very solid backstop for the Gents.
Gaunt is definitely a strong kid, but not to the degree of Chris Zapata.
Fouled off.
Chris was an animal.
Yeah. That was my freshman year here, the 2017 championship season, where Zapata hit 391, blasted 12 home runs, won all these awards, and just carried the Gents along with Michael Schimpf to that regular season championship and the SCAC postseason title as well, as that one was swung on and missed.
I mean, we saw it, I believe it was during the Southwestern series, Chris Zapata took a line drive off the chest like it was nothing.
Been
dude
there,
was just an
that.
Animal.
Yeah. 2-2. Swing and a miss. Malone got him to chase. Strikeout number two for the Gents right-hander. And he's settled down nicely after the leadoff double with two down. That brings up Tyler Hedden.
Batting seventh, shortstop, number 26, Tyler Hedden.
And Malone's already at 19 pitches, done really good job limiting the amount of pitches he has thrown so far through this inning and two-thirds. So, you know, talking to Coach Diaz before the game, he said, you know, he was going to have Malone go out there, give him one or two innings. If he goes three or four, great. Well, Malone's definitely on pace to go three or four today.
Yeah, another first pitch strike to begin this at-bat, and misses there, and it's 1-1. And I think the Letourneau lineup's kind of helping him out. They're swinging at an awful lot of first and second pitches in their at-bats.
Yeah, so far they seem like a very aggressive offense, so I think it's going to be important for the Gents to throw strikes early in the count throughout this game.
Backs him off the plate, and it's two balls and a strike on Hedden. I think we saw Nick Delonneville in the chat section of today's broadcast. Nice to see him again. He was a guest analyst a couple weekends ago when Gents played the Southwestern Pirates. That's a high chopper. And Menard's going to let that one trickle foul.
Very smart of Clay over there at third to let that one trickle foul. Ball had a lot of spin on it, and as we know here at Sheehy, down the lines, it can get a little tricky when a ball's put on the ground, not very hard.
Talking about how Gaunt reminds us of Zapata, for me at least, Menard reminds me a lot of Ian Graham.
Yes.
Great defensive third baseman. I know he's a left-handed hitter, Menard is, but kind of the same type of hitter, soft hitting, not a lot of power, but definitely gets on base and will pick up those singles.
Yeah, and he just puts the ball in play.
And speaking of singles, that one's going to drop in front of Benoit. He comes up firing to the plate, but it's up the line. Gaunt's throw to second is going to get into center. And Keith trying to argue that the batter runner got in the way of him receiving that throw. But regardless, that's probably going to go down as an E2. And that'll play to run for Letourneau. It's 3-1.
Batting eighth, second baseman, number one, Ethan Wood.
It's one of those tough errors because the throw from Gaunt wasn't really bad. It was just bad timing with Hedden kind of coming to the second base bag right at the same time. There's a chopper to third. Menard charges and throws on to first. So the inning comes to a close with little damage, but Letourneau does get on the board as we go to the bottom half of the second inning from Sheehy Stadium. It's the Gents 3, Yellow Jackets 1.
for the Jets. Catcher, number 24, Jay Gong.
Jay Gong squares around on the first pitch, gets a bunt down, and Davis, a low throw to first, dug out by Neighbors. Play goes 1-3, trying to take him by surprise, and almost worked out, but one pitch and one out.
Batting ninth, designated hitter, number 14, Gage Morris.
So here's the DH, Gage Morris, right-handed hitting freshman. Takes the first pitch, fastball up and away for ball one. Gents lead 3-1 in the second. First of two seven-inning ball games today, as next pitch is fired in for a called strike. It's 1-1. Way outside, and in the words of Bob Uecker, just a bit outside. Brewers radio broadcaster, 90 years old, still doing games for Milwaukee. In on his hands and grounded left side. The shortstop head in is over. Gets a throw off in time to nab Morris at first for out number two.
Left fielder, Carson Livesay.
So the Gents lineup turns over for Carson Livesay. Walked in his first plate appearance. Part of a three-run first for the Gents. First pitch he sees stays too far outside. 1-0. Fastball away, and Livesay ahead in the count, 2-0. And another pitch outside. Davis not wanting to go in to Livesay, and he's behind in the count. Davis is 3-0. Next pitch, outside, ball four. Four-pitch walk issued to Livesay, and the Gents have a two-out base runner for Clay Menard.
Third baseman, Clay Menard.
First pitch off the outside edge. Five straight balls from Davis. Menard was hit by a pitch back in the first inning. Shows bunt, pulls back, and takes a pitch. It's a called strike. Runner goes. Pitch is a called strike, dropped by Vaughn. So it'll be a stolen base for Livesay. Moves him into scoring position, though with two outs. Menard will have to get a ball into the outfield to bring him home.
Livesay, the Gents leader in stolen bases on the season, now with number 17 on the season.
1-2 to Menard, checks a swing, takes low. No swing, says the home plate umpire. So the count evens at 2-2. Deuce is wild. 2-2, 2-2. Pitch is taken outside. And Menard works the count full. 3-2. Alex Miller waits on deck. He'd hit next should the inning continue. Miller got the Gents on the board with that three-run bomb.
Menard, a very patient hitter at the plate. Doesn't strike out often. Only 10 on the year with 25 walks.
One of those rare strikeouts as Davis got him to chase the fastball high. So Menard down on strikes, Livesay stranded at second, and the inning comes to a close. We'll head to the top of the third inning. It's the Gents 3, Yellow Jackets 1. 9-1 and 2 in the Letourneau order, set to lead off in the third inning. Zach Zarco blasts that one high in the air, deep to left, but foul. One hopping the wall in foul ground behind the Gents' bullpen. Got a good piece of that one, but it twisted foul, and it's a harmless strike one. Zarco leading off for Letourneau, his first at-bat of game one. Gents lead 3-1, top of the third inning. Next pitch from Malone, swung on and fouled off to the right. This kind of reminds me of when I play MLB The Show and I just swing at everything. I don't take pitches in The Show. I'm just swinging away all the time. This kind of reminds me of that. Lifted to center. Hit. Coming in, Boone going back. It's Pitts, the center fielder, who makes the call and makes the catch for out number one.
Designated hitter, Hayden Norris.
Back to the top of the Letourneau order for the DH, Hayden Norris.
Yeah, Pierre, if you're swinging at everything in MLB Show, it's pretty easy to swing at everything at a higher difficulty, so that just means you're good, right?
Yeah. That's the way I think about it.
At least that's how I view myself. I haven't played the show in quite some time.
Yeah.
Don't have the time anymore.
Right. For all the parents and grandparents listening, the big baseball video game is called MLB The Show.
It's about all we would ever play in the clubhouse.
Right. 2-0. Swung on, lifted right side, Miller giving chase, and it'll land foul. Remember my freshman year, my good friend Colin Sharkey, former Diamond Gent, and I kind of set out to create a custom team, the 2017 Diamond Gents. And we would update it every year, but that 2017 team, players have rankings in that game, and I know that Michael Schimpf and Chris Potter were both 99 overalls, which is the highest you can be. Gave Zapata, the most power you could give a player, and Schimpf the best contact. Three, one, backs him off the plate, so there's a one out walk.
First baseman, Xander Neighbors.
Up here, if Michael Schimpf had the best contact in the game, it gives me a boost of confidence for when I was a player, because I struck him out in the alumni game my freshman year.
Wow, there you go.
So, man, I wish I would have known he was a 99.
Yeah,
when I was a freshman.
I know we updated that every year. I think I know your freshman year. I'm pretty sure you were an 88. So that's
not
good.
Bad.
That's a good testament. I know you're in the 90s somewhere. As I think that 2020 was the last year I actually, did anything with that custom roster. And you're in the 90s, two-way guy. The way you had to do it was you had to have two different players that look exactly the same. One of them a pitcher, one of them a hitter, to kind of bypass that because they didn't have two-way guys
back
then.
Game, yeah,
that was pre-Shohei. Although I understand now you can create your own stadium in the game, man. I would have loved to do that with the Gold Dome and Sheehy Stadium, but that one's fired in for a strike. Instead, I had to settle for Capitol Field, which was not a real stadium. It's one of their little generic fake stadiums they have in the game, but it was supposed to be like at the United States Capitol. And in left center field, there was a gold-plated dome, not as big as the one we have here in left center, but it was as close as we could get in the late 2010s technology.
It's the one stadium I always hated playing at.
Popped up, shallow right center, Keith giving chase, and it's Boone, and it's going to drop. Just served out to no man's land. Neighbors is aboard. Two on now for Letourneau for Kevin Soto.
Third baseman, Kevin Soto.
I think we're going to have a defensive replacement.
Wow.
I think that's Braden Morse. He's going to come into the game for Miles Keith at second base.
For the Gents, number 11, Braden Morris will play second base.
So Morris at second, that's kind of surprising. I didn't see Keith do anything that would have warranted him getting pulled. Did you?
I think he just kind of took his time trying to get to that ball and was a little bit lazy there. I could barely hear Mike Diaz down on the field, head coach for the Gents, kind of yelling towards Keith. I think it was just the initial go get after it from Keith that just wasn't there. I think that's the reason why he may have got pulled there.
So Kevin Soto, the batter, swung on and missed. 2-1. I want to say Nick Delonneville in the game was a 78 overall. Real solid backup catcher and reserve infielder. Both runners go, and Gauntz blocks it in the dirt. So Letourneau threatening here. Pair of runners in scoring position, one out. They're down by two. Gents have double barrel action warming up in the bullpen. Lefty and a righty both getting loose. Malone from the stretch deals the 3-1. Grounded, high chopper. Malone off the mound, throws to first. Miller throw to second is going to be taken by Menard, who throws home. I think some of the Gents were expecting that to be called a foul ball because it really took a ricochet after it hit the ground, but no such call was made. And so it's a 3-2 ball game.
Catcher Jagger Vaughn.
Really weird play. Malone fielded the high chop off the mound, threw to first in time to get him, and then Miller tried to backpick the runner, retreating to second. And Menard's throw home as the lead runner at third took off to try to score. Menard's throw was just too late. And so it's a 3-2 Gents lead now with two down and a runner at second. And Malone falls behind Jagger Vaughn, two balls and no strikes. Fastball outside, and just like that, 3-0. Cade Hathorn waits on deck. If Vaughn can reach, he'll hit next. Malone coming home with the 3-0. Fastball right down the middle for strike one.
I'd imagine this will probably be Zachary Malone's last inning here.
3-1. Swung on, fouled off to the right and out of play. So the count runs full. 3-2 on the Letourneau cleanup hitter, Jagger Vaughn. Payoff pitch on its way. Cracked into left. Livese gonna turn and watch that one sail on out of here. Go-ahead two-run home run for Jagger Vaughn. And in the blink of an eye, Letourneau takes the lead. It's 4-3, Yellow Jackets. Well, he got all of that one.
Yeah, I'd like to see the exit velo on that. That thing was out of here in a hurry.
And Mike Diaz is out of the third base dugout in a hurry. Likely will be it for Malone, as you can already see the reliever for the Gents jogging in from the bullpen. It started off pretty well for Malone, but running into some trouble here in the third as he relinquishes the lead. and exits with Gents down by run. New pitcher coming on for Centenary. We'll tell you about him when we return from Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport. It's the Yellow Jackets 4, Gents 3. The lefty Tyler Herrera on in relief for the Gents. First pitch misses low and away. Lefty against lefty as Cade Hathorn bats now with the bases clear and two down. Letourneau leads 4-3. High pop up right side. Miller approaching the wall and it's going to be caught by Morris, who calls him off, the Gents' second baseman. On the warning track, makes the catch. So, just a couple pitches for Herrera to get out of the third inning. As we go to the last half of the third, it's Letourneau 4, Centenary 3.
Now pitching, number 45, Hayden Peoples. leading off for the Jets, first baseman, Alex Miller.
Ready to begin the bottom of the third inning here from Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport. Caden Peoples on in relief for Letourneau. The right-hander twists a breaking ball that just misses. It's 1-0 on Alex Miller. Gents down by a run, trying to get back in it. 1-0, beg your pardon, stays up high, and it's two balls and no strikes on Alex Miller. Gents' number three hitter will be followed by Austin Benoit and Joby Boone. From the stretch, here's the pitch. Up and in, and it's 3-0. And there's the fourth wide one. So Miller draws a four-pitch walk to begin matters here in the Gents' third. And that'll bring up the aforementioned Austin Benoit.
Right fielder, Austin Benoit.
So Preston, you looked at the exit velocity for that long home run in the top half.
It surprised me. It was only 99 off the bat.
Wow. It looked a lot harder as Benoit squares, pulls the bat back, and takes a ball.
Yeah, it did look a lot harder than 99. I was expecting 105 plus. That one got out in a hurry. About an 18, 19 degree launch angle off the bat and traveled about 390 so feet.
Benoit takes a strike. It's 1-1. Not quite as far as the 495 foot home run we saw last homestand against Southwestern, huh?
Yeah, no. I don't think I'll ever see a ball hit that far in my life again.
Throw to first, Miller's back standing.
Yep, here it's very rare that you see a ball get hit over the center field wall at Sheehy, just because the ball does not travel very far here.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that it hit off the top of the light pole, the left one over our center field fence, and then bounced off of that onto the dome, just don't see that every day here.
Yeah. Runner goes, check swing, and over the head of Neighbors, the first baseman in foul ground, not able to get that one. So the count moves to 3-2. Payoff pitch, runner goes. Pitch is taken inside. So the first two Gents have walked here in the third. And Joby Boone bats now with a couple runners aboard.
Shortstop, Joby Boone.
As the Yellow Jackets infield converges on the mound.
Here, what do you think we'll see here?
Oh no, I know Coach Diaz likes to, bunt a lot. But Boone's a good hitter. I think he's fast enough to evade a double play potentially, unless it's just rocketed right at an infielder. It would just, the Gents are only down by one.
I think Boone's gonna have the green light to swing away here. At least on pitch number one, and then after that, I think he's going to bunt. Oh, never mind.
Swinging away. lifts it to right. Hathorn makes the grab. Miller tags from second. Hathorn's throw to third is going to be cut off. Good base running there by Miller as the lead runner advances to third. Benoit holds it first. So with one out and runners at the corners, that'll bring up Braden Morse for his first at-bat.
Second baseman, Braden Morse.
Morse took over defensively for Keith and swings at the first pitch and fouls it back to the screen.
Saw Joby Boone had his hands choked up a little bit on the bat. I thought he was going to bunt, but I was mistaken.
Runner goes, pitch is swung on, and fouled off to the left. Nothing in two now on Morse. Throw over to first, and Benoit dives back. O-2. Fouled off. Good battle brewing here between Peoples and Morse. Who do you think has the best name on the Waterno roster?
Ooh.
We got Caden Peoples pitching to Jagger Vaughn behind the plate. Zach Zarco in center. Some good baseball names. Runner goes. Pitch is grounded up the middle. And it gets through into center. And the game is tied. The second baseman, Wood, tried to backhand that while his foot was on the bag, trying to at least get the force at second and maybe turn two, but got right past him into center, and we're all knotted at four. So that'll be ruled a hit. Just kind of olayed that at the second base bag, did Wood, as once again Volturno will meet on the mound. And so Morse will pick up an RBI. Benoit takes third, and so once again, Gents will have runners at the corners, one down for Colin Pitts.
Yeah, Pierre, going back to your question, I got two of them.
All right.
TJ Spadowski.
Whew, there you go.
And Will Podsednik.
Nice.
Great names.
Yeah.
Hard to pronounce, but I love them.
The big Spadowski, right? And yeah, Podsednik kind of harkens you back to Scott Podsednik, who was big-time base stealer. Yeah, we got some comments in the on the broadcast.
Center fielder, Colin Pitts.
From Nick Delonneville, I mentioned earlier, Nick, that you were a 78, at least your junior year, which is pretty solid. Throw over, runner's back. I tried to be as, you know, honest with the rankings as I could be, and you know, problem with the show is that as Pitts grounds that one to third, it's past Soto into left. This is going to give the Gents the lead as Benoit crosses home. An RBI hit for Colin Pitts makes it 5-4 Gents.
Catcher Jay Gong.
RBI single for Colin Pitts. 5-4 5-4, Gents.
I think that's going to do it for Peebles.
Yep, I think you're right. New pitcher coming on for Letourneau. And finish what I was saying, it was, you know, the thing about the show is that, you know, you're playing major league teams, so, you know, it's kind of like on an MLB scale that all, you know, Schimpf and Zapata, are they really 99s overall compared to other major leaguers? No, but I'm doing it based on, you know,
the competitive value here.
I'm doing it based on the SCAC, so I think in the SCAC that's true. But yeah, Nick Delonneville was a 78. I think I was a 57. Just no hitting, but great defense is what I had myself set to. Noah, Caleb Kirk was in the 90s. Matt DeVille, I think, was a 90 on the dot. Laverne was, I want to say, an 88. We took that stuff down to a T, not just the attributes, but the, you know, the accessories, the batting gloves, and the fielding mitts, and batting stances. I think I gave you Buster Posey's batting
stance. Speaking of that, how many accessories did you put on my player?
Oh, my gosh. Everything you could give, the arm guard, the leg guard, the wrist tape, and of course, the batting gloves, and
a C flap on the
I think the wrist guard too. There's an Eva Field wrist guard. I think mostly catchers use that, but I think we put that on you as well.
Well, at one point I did actually use those in high school.
Wow.
Yeah. So you have it right.
Yeah. That was one of my favorite things, was getting the batting stances and the pitching windups, you know, as close as I could. And I think I gave you Buster Posey's, at least for a while. Colin Sharkey had Brad Ziegler, the former sidewinder, spent some years with the Diamondbacks.
Well, Pierre, as we wrap up this warm-up for the new pitcher, who's actually one of my choices for a favorite name on the Letourneau lineup, TJ Spadowski,
for Letourneau,
now pitching for the Yellow Jackets.
Number 11, TJ Spadowski.
So Spitalski on the mound, and Gaunt first to greet him. A couple runners aboard. First pitch is just low for a ball.
Look good from up here. Must have just missed.
So after the Gents coughed up the lead in the top after the third, they storm right back in the bottom half to retake it. It's 5-4 Gents now. One out. A couple runners on. They both go. Hit and run was on. Swung on and missed. Throw down to third. It's going to be in time to get him. Morse tried to swim around the tag, but to no avail. And he's caught stealing for out number two. On the play, Pitts advances to second. One, lined past the dive of the third baseman Soto down the left field line into the bullpen. Diaz is going to wave home Pitts, and that one gets out of play, so it'll be an RBI ground rule double for Jake Gaunt. And that extends the Gents' lead to 6-4. Looks like we might see a pinch hitter here.
Yeah, I think we are. Now that the righty's in the game, I think we're going to have Walker Wicklund for the Gents coming up to bat. Number 18, the freshman from right here out of Shreveport, Louisiana.
For the Gents, number 18, Walker Wicklund will bat for Morris.
Captain Shreve High School product bats with Gaunt out at second. Two outs. Pitch to the left-handed hitting Wicklund is swung on and missed. Nothing in one.
Tell you what I like right there. First swing as a pinch hitter. Swinging at a fastball. for a strike. Love that as a pinch hitter. Swinging at good pitches early. I mean, that's what you're there to do is swing the bat and put the ball in play.
It's a tough assignment because you're sitting – I know it's only the third, but you're sitting there for an hour, you know, watching the action, and you're just kind of idle. So being thrust right into it when you're, you know,
yeah, and especially not fresh, I mean, really. Especially when you're on the bench, you're trying to watch the pitcher, you know, just in case your name does get called. Well, T.J. Spadowski, the new pitcher, has only faced like one or two batters, I think, actually just one up until this point. So very hard assignment for Wicklund.
That one gets past Vaughn to the backstop. Gaunce down to third. It'll be a passed ball charged to Vaughn. And a 3-1 count on Wicklund. Swing and a miss. Got him to fish for it, and the count runs full. Three-two. Wind into right, and it's going to be tracked down by Hathorne.
Great at bat by Wicklund, though.
Put a good swing on it, but unfortunately for Wicklund and the Gents, he hit it right at him, and so the runner is stranded at third. But the Gents score three runs and retake the lead as we go to the top of the fourth inning. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4. First pitch to Dylan Cortez misses up and away. It's a ball and no strikes. Tyler Herrera back out there for the Gents. He got the final out in the top of the third inning. Gents lead 6-4 here in the top of the fourth inning as that one finds the zone, a ball and a strike. One pitch stays too far outside. Swing and a foul tip, and so the count evens at 2-2. Two-two is lifted in the air, right side. Herrera makes the call, but Gaunce calls him off last second. Herrera wanted it, but the Jets catcher taking charge and makes the catch.
A little bit of a nail biter there on the infield as the pitcher and catcher kind of laugh that one off.
Shortstop, Tyler Headed.
Yeah, they're laughing now because they, you know, retired the batter, but would not have been laughing if that one dropped.
Gaunce said, you don't have any part of that, Tyler.
Good bunt. Gaunce is going to tell Menard to let it roll foul. And
that.
Great job. You saw Gaunce make the call, say no. And Menard listens to his catcher wisely, and it trickles foul.
Any other field, that'd be a base hit. But not here at Sheehy.
Breaking pitch, and it's a good one from Herrera. Catches the outer third, and it's nothing and two.
Backdoor curveball is very effective when he uses it the right way.
Swing and a miss. Gaunce will throw down to first to complete the strikeout. Play goes 2-3. And Herrera picks up his first strikeout of this relief appearance.
Second baseman, Ethan Wood.
So with two down, in steps the second baseman, Ethan Wood. First pitch fastball right there for strike one. Swing and a miss, and Herrera out in front, nothing and two.
I think he goes back to the changeup here.
From the stretch, the 0-2. Low and away, one and two.
Did. Tried to get him to chase.
It was a good pitch, but
good job by Zarco to hold off on that one.
One, two. In the dirt. Two balls and two strikes. Herrera last worked in game two of Saturday's doubleheader against St. Thomas. Three and a third inning, gave up four earned runs. So, as you said, Preston, trying to get his confidence back, and good chance to do so here in a midweek non-conference game. Still has some gas in the tank, only threw 55 pitches in his start, and there's a swing and a miss. Herrera got him to chase. Strikeout number two for the Gents southpaw. Picks up two strikeouts in the inning, posts a scoreless fourth, and that'll do it for the Yellow Jackets in their half and fourth. We'll go to the home half. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4.
The Gents, left fielder, Carson Livesey.
Top three in the Gents lineup set to face Spitalski, the Yellow Jackets reliever, in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Centenary leads Letourneau 6-4 as Olivise takes a pitch that misses for ball one. From the stretch, the 1-0 is swung on and grounded right side. Second baseman on a couple hops. Fields and throws on to first. Wood on to Neighbors. Play goes 4-3. And Livese is a ground out victim to begin the fourth.
Third baseman, Clay Menard.
So here's Clay Menard. First pitch fastball in there for strike one. Swing and a miss. Healthy cut by Menard, but couldn't quite catch up to the fastball, and it's a nothing and two. Upstairs, 1-2.
Just off the plate.
A good take there by Menard.
Yeah, as I said earlier, he's a very patient batter. He'll work the count.
Pokes that one back to the screen. Called strike three.
Just on the inside edge.
Menard down looking. Good pitch by Spitalski. So with two outs, that brings up the first baseman, Alex Miller.
First baseman, Alex Miller.
Half of the Gents' six runs came from one swing by Miller back in the first, a three-run shot. Gave the Gents a 3-0 lead. They briefly lost the lead when it was 4-3 Letourneau before scoring another three runs. That's where the score stands as of now, 6-4 Gents in the fourth.
And we were talking about his strength earlier during that at bat. Looking at him, you wouldn't think that he's a strong kid. Now, he is 6'7", so he is tall. He's got the limbs, but he's not necessarily that big. He's very, very skinny. But just natural strength. You know, I see him from time to time in the fitness center here on campus, and he's over there lifting some heavy weight.
Oh, yeah.
He's a strong kid.
I think for the skinnier ball player, two things are paramount for power if you're going to be that kind of frame. Quick wrists as that pitch is taken low and away. And just a fast swing, a quick swing.
Yeah, super fast hands and staying through the zones. Yeah. Staying through the zone is what it comes down to.
Fouled back to the screen.
Good job battling that one back.
You know who was really skinny but had some good pop for the Pirates when he first came up was Andrew McCutchen.
Yes.
Skinny kid, came up at the age of 22, and he sacked 12 home runs each of his first two seasons despite not being a power hitter, and that was before, you know, everyone and their grandma was hitting 20 home runs in a season.
Yeah, you could say the same thing about someone like Ken Griffey Jr. Yeah. Adrian Beltre, when he first came up into the league, he was really, really small.
Popped foul behind us here in the press box.
I mean, heck, even Miguel Cabrera.
Yeah, good one. Hey, you look at those old 2003 Florida Marlins clips and got to do a double take. Like, wow, that one's hit high in the air to left, but with room is Cortez. On the left field foul line, makes the catch. So Miller with another deep fly ball, but this time it's an F7. And the Gents go down in order. We'll go to the top of the fifth inning. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4. Logan Schmidt on in relief for the Gents as Zach Zarco offers at a pitch trying to get a bunt down but came up empty. Nothing and one on the Yellow Jackets center fielder. Next pitch from Schmidt is swung on and missed. Quickly, nothing and two. Schmidt on in relief for Tyler Herrera. Malone and Herrera both picked up two strikeouts, and Schmidt with a fastball that stays too far upstairs.
That wind, as I mentioned earlier, was kind of dead, is now picking up.
And a swing and a miss. So Schmidt picks up a strikeout, his first. So a good start to Schmidt's relief outing. So the Letourneau order flips over. And here's the DH, Hayden Morris, who takes a called strike. Logan Schmidt, a freshman out of Pearland, Texas. Fouled off. Nothing in two. And that's what we were talking about, Preston, at the beginning of the broadcast. Guys like Schmidt, who don't normally appear in the conference games, normally you see the likes of Jacob Broussard or the starter in this non-conference game, Zach Malone, getting relief assignments. Aiden Rychek this season, working back from injury, appearing a lot out of the bullpen. But guys like Logan Schmidt now have an opportunity to show Mike Diaz, hey, you know, I can get batters out at this level.
Absolutely. You're 100% correct there. Schmidt has a good opportunity here as he's already gotten one early on four pitches.
Trying to open some eyes from the windup. Here's the 2-2. Breaking ball just outside. A sweeper. Didn't get him to chase.
Well, the thing with Schmidt, he's got four pitches. The problem with him is sometimes he can be a little little wild there on the mound, and that's the big factors to why Coach Diaz has probably not played him, as opposed to someone like Hank Bennett, who doesn't get a whole lot of innings, but you know what you're going to get out of him every single time when he goes out there, because he throws strikes. So good opportunity for Schmidt to show what he can do.
Swing and a miss. Back-to-back strikeouts for the freshman. Two down. He's showing what he can do right out of the gate.
First baseman, Xander Neighbors.
Here's the first baseman, Xander Neighbors. First pitch, breaking ball outside for a ball. So you were saying before we started the commentary today, we have Xander and Soto, kind of reminiscent of the San Diego Padres teams in years past. There's another swing and a miss, 1-1. Xander Bogaerts now at second base for the Padres, and Juan Soto, who spent a couple years in San Diego before being traded to the Yankees in the offseason.
It's like we said, they got a lot of cool names on this team.
Yeah. Well, Schmidt, one strike away from potentially striking out the side from the wind. Here's the 1-2. Fastball stays up and away, and the count evens at 2.
Who do you think of when you hear Ludwig, Pierre?
Ryan Ludwig.
Yes.
One-time Pirate.
Yes.
Spent a lot of years with the Padres and the Cardinals. That one's in the dirt.
Believe it or not, we are not related, unfortunately. That would have been really cool.
Yeah, one of the rare righty-hitting, lefty-throwing players in MLB. Don't really see that too often, but Ludwig and Cody Ross come to mind. Payoff pitch from Schmidt. Upstairs, ball 4. Two-out walk.
Madison Bumgarner.
Yeah, there you go, yeah. So here's Kevin Soto. Yellow Jackets third baseman. What's even rarer is a switch hitting left-handed thrower.
Mm-hmm.
Lance Berkman was one of them, and throw it first, nothing doing. You didn't see it very often, but Wandy Rodriguez was as well. Former Astros pitcher, spent some years in Pittsburgh.
I've actually got a card signed by him.
Do you?
Yeah.
That's cool.
My grandfather actually gave it to me a while back when I was younger.
Swing and a miss. It's cool. Speaking of Ryan Ludwig, I was at his first game as a Pirate after the Bucks picked him up at the 2011 trade deadline from the Padres. Pirates got Ludwig and Derek Lee, two separate trades. Lee picked up from the Orioles, trying to make a playoff push, but wasn't going to happen that year for the Pirates. They collapsed toward the season's end. But that first game for Lee and Ludwig, Derek Lee, who spent a lot of years with the Chicago Cubs, I know our crack SID, Patrick Meehan, knows him well from watching all those Cubs games, but Derek Lee hit 2 home runs against his former team, the Cubs, in early August of 2011. I was at that game. I was 13 years old, and I was loving it. 2 home runs. One was off Carlos Zambrano, and the other off of Kerry Wood, at that point in his career, a reliever. Pirates ended up losing that game. Go figure. I think it was a 5-3 final. Paul Mahalem got the start for the Pirates and did not bode well for him, and I was none too pleased as there's a ground ball to third. Menard on a hop. Throws to second. Gets the force out the short way. And so a good inning for Schmidt. 2 strikeouts. And strands a runner at first. We'll head to the home half of the 5th inning. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4.
for the Jets, right fielder Austin Tenwa.
Zach Schneider on in relief for the Yellow Jackets. The left-hander deals first pitch to Austin Benoit, leading off the Gents' half of the fifth. Centenary leads by 2 runs, and it's a called strike one on Benoit. Next pitch just misses, 1-1.
Schneider on the year for the Yellow Jackets, an 0-2 record, 12 appearances. 15 innings of work on the mound, giving up 10 earned runs.
Benoit swings but comes up empty. Count moves to 1-2. Outside, 2-2 now. Poked foul right side, so we'll do it again. High chopper, but it's going to be called a foul ball. Home plate umpire rules it got a piece of Benoit, it would appear. Some mid-at-bat music here at Sheehy Stadium.
Last home series, it was our scoreboard operator. Now it's the guy on music.
2-2, stays outside. You know what that reminded me of? If you watched Major League Baseball during the 2020 COVID season, some ballparks, and I remember the Pirates were playing a series in Minneapolis against the Twins. It was so weird. They would play...
Crowd noise.
Yes, there was a nice play by Neighbors on a one-hop smash off the bat of Benoit. Takes it to the back himself for out number one.
Shortstop, Joby Boone.
But I don't know how long this lasted for. I don't know if it was just the Twins or what, but in the middle of the at-bat, in between pitches, they would play music. Just random songs. As a song continues to play here during the at-bat, during the pitch. You know, if that would have happened in the SCAC tourney, that pitch wouldn't have been allowed to happen. As you recall, Colin Pitts crushed a home run that was ruled a no-swing because the music was playing, which we had seen prior to and after that Pitts at-bat. But for some reason, because something pivotal happened, the umpires end up ruling no-swing as Boone takes it off the foot.
I think he hit off the foot and came up and hit him in the face.
Ooh. Well, Boone's going to trot down to first. A hit by pitch. Puts a runner aboard for the Gents with one down for Braden Morse.
Second baseman, Braden Morse.
But it was just so weird having mid at-bat music during a Major League Baseball game. That was actually a series, if anyone remembers this, there was a drone overhead at Target Field.
I do remember
and that.
And that
stopped, play for a long time. I remember watching that live. I'm like, what is going on?
Same thing with the random fan at Fenway.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I remember that. There's a pitch outside. Throw down to first by Vaughn. Not in time. Yeah, so during the COVID season when fans were not permitted to watch regular season games in person, there was a fan apparently who snuck in to Fenway Park in Boston.
Yeah, he's up on the Green Monster. I remember that.
And the cameras caught him eventually. And
kind of reminds me of the movie Ted sneaking into the park at midnight.
Yeah, fans found their way to the ballpark that season and tried to watch it any way they could. Of course, some capacity was allowed during the playoffs, but even during the regular season, you know, I know in St. Louis and particularly in Chicago, there's a little organization, Wrigley Rooftops, which isn't owned by the Cubs or Wrigley Field. It's, you know, rooftops on some buildings that are outside Wrigley Field.
Or is that out in right field?
Yeah, I think there's one in right and in left.
Okay.
So I know some fans tried to and were able to watch the games from afar in those rooftop seats, which, you know, they were bleachers. You have your little cup holders. You can, you know, have your ballpark food. It pretty much just felt like a ballpark experience. But
you have the same thing out in St. Louis with the bars out in left center. Almost reminds me of Cornerstone University.
That one's Michigan. Slashed down the right field line. It's getting down fair. Morse on his horse.
Hustle double.
Yeah, slides into second.
Love to see it.
One out double for Braden Morse. So the gents with two runners in scoring position now for Colin Pitts.
Yeah, the one field that one of my former high school teammates went to was Cornerstone University up in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And behind home plate, you have some dormitory buildings for some of the student athletes. And they have balconies and windows out there where you can watch the game right there from behind home plate.
That's cool. No balls and two strikes on Pitts. That's the thing about baseball is that, you know, every other sport, the venues are so uniform. As Pitts offers at a pitch way up high, and throw from the pitcher off the ricochet from the backstop is in time to get Pitts at first. He swung and missed at a pitch way upstairs, and so the play goes strikeout 1-3. You don't see that every day, but
yeah, missed the padding right there on the backstop behind home plate.
Catcher Jake Gons.
There's not a whole lot of room of space of brick right there behind home plate. There's only about 6 inches or so above and below the padding that is just brick.
Here's the catcher, Jake Gontz. First pitch swinging, slashes it foul wide at first. Boone at third, and Morse at second. Gents lead by a pair. Schneider from the stretch. Here's the 0-1. Swing and a miss. 24th with a bat in the on-deck circle. He would pinch hit for Wickland against the left-hander if the inning continues. O-2. Wafted in foul ground, and that'll get down out of play. So the count stays 0-2.
Straight into the bathroom over at Virginia's place.
How many times are we going to see that this season?
I think it's only the second time we've seen that, but how unique for it to not even bounce off of anything and just go straight in.
Looks like one of the softball players over to retrieve it. Nothing in two. Once again, fastball up high. 1-2 on Gons.
Well, last time we saw a ball go into the bathroom, we also saw a dog run into the bathroom. That dog was on a mission.
The centenary ball dog.
Just don't see that often. It's not like it was getting lost or anything either. It just went right in there.
Yeah.
You see some crazy things at some baseball games up here.
Yeah, I was walking into the stadium today. A ball flew right by me. Bounced off a car on a hop as that one's lined to center, but unfortunately for Gontz, it's right at Zarco. He puts that one away, and the inning is over. Gents strand a pair. We'll go to the top of the sixth inning. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4. Jagger Vaughn leading off for Letourneau as we begin the sixth inning. Gents lead 6-4 as Schmidt back out there for the Gents. Fires in a strike, nothing and one. Logan Schmidt from the wind deals the next offering, a breaking ball. And he gets a call there, strike two. Vaughn didn't agree with it, right on the outside black. Vaughn homered his last time up. The line drive, 99 mile an hour off the bat shot. And a swing and a miss. Strikeout number three for Schmidt. Has that pitch working for him. Out number one.
Right fielder, Cade Hathorn.
So here's Cade Hathorn. The Letourneau right fielder, left-handed hitter. First pitch coming home. Checks and takes upstairs, ball one. Gents with a couple of righties loosening in their bullpen. And the 1-0 fastball gets a piece of Hathorn, so he'll trot down to first. One out base runner for Letourneau. And that'll bring up the left fielder, Dylan Cortez.
Left fielder, Dylan Cortez.
First pitch bender in there for a strike.
If I'm on the Yellow Jackets offense, I'm sitting slider. He's got that pitch working for him really well right now.
Pitch misses outside. It's 1-1. You know, I was a Yellow Jacket for one season. My freshman year at C.E. Byrd High School here in town. A Byrd Yellow Jacket, only got three innings defensively and a couple plate appearances, walked in both of them for entering the transfer portal, as it were, jokingly, of course, and heading down to South Shreveport to become a Southwood Cowboy for the next 3 years. And former Gent outfielder Bobby Gillum was my head coach down there at Southwood. Now with BPSI, the community college across the Red River. Three-one from Schmidt is fouled off. What was your high school mascot?
Panthers.
That's right.
Pflugerville Panthers.
High drive into pretty deep center field. Pitts gives chase, and it's off the wall. Throw into the infield from Pitts. Will hold the lead runner at third, but it's a ringing double for Dylan Cortez.
I think the Panthers are bad luck. We're gonna stop talking about them.
Yeah.
Shortstop, Tyler Hedden.
No, in all seriousness, no. Pflugerville Panthers, if anyone knows where Pflugerville is, in between Austin and Round Rock, so I like to say I'm from a place between a weird place and a rock and a weird place. Sorry, I messed up that saying. But
yeah.
Just for reference, Round Rock and Austin, keep Austin weird. Rock in a weird place.
Round Rock, home of the Express.
Yep.
The AAA affiliate of the Rangers.
I think they're the Astros now.
Sugarland's AAA Astros.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
They were. You're right. It
goes back and forth so much. I can't tell you how many times the ownership has changed.
Yeah. The Express for many years were the Rangers affiliate when I was growing up. And when I started at Centenary, they were. And then they kind of had a realignment. The Rangers sent their AAA affiliate over to Nashville with the Sounds.
The Sounds.
And then the Astros, who had their AAA affiliate for some reason in Fresno, the Grizzlies in California, ended up coming closer to home. And they took over the Round Rock operation and had their AAA affiliate with the Express. And then I think around 2020 or so, they realigned again.
Yep.
Sugarland, formerly the Sugar Land Skeeters, became a minor league affiliate with affiliated with Major League Baseball, and then the Rangers moved back to Texas.
Yep.
Retook over the Express. So now both Texas Major League clubs have AAA affiliates in the state of Texas. Both are AA affiliates in Texas as well. The Frisco Rough Riders for the Rangers and the Corpus Christi Hooks for the Astros.
First ever ball game I ever went to at a professional level was a Frisco Rough Rider game.
Really?
Yep.
It's cool. They got a good
but
ballpark.
Being from Dallas, being born in Plano, I lived in Frisco until I was about 5 years old. So that was my first ball game I ever went to.
For the Jets, now pitching, number 17, Aiden Rychek.
And with all the changes as far as organizations and affiliations for professional baseball, the Rough Riders, one of my old coaches, Vic Trevino, his brother Jose, if anyone knows that name, Jose Trevino is a catcher for the New York Yankees. He was an Oral Roberts product and got drafted by the Rangers in one of the late rounds and was a Gold Glove finalist and winner for multiple seasons with the Rough Riders before they went to the Sounds. And then from the Sounds, he got promoted that season and played a little bit with the Rangers and ultimately got traded as a free agent to the Yankees. They picked him up, and he was an all-star not too long ago.
Yeah, Trevino getting some starts out there in New York now. A fine career for the catcher, as Aiden Rychek is now on in relief for the Gents.
Yeah, I know we mentioned a few streams ago, but we were talking about how I was a catcher at one point. Well, a lot of my lessons came from Jose.
Wow.
Back when he was still in college playing Oral Roberts, he would come down during the summer and help some of us out. So it's a cool experience as a kid growing up.
That is cool. Yeah, the only big leaguer I ever got lessons from was a guy named Glenn Wilson, who spent some years with the Pirates, two different stints, was an all-star with the Phillies, but made his home in Houston and had a little baseball facility there. I was 14 at the time. Got some hacks in the cages with Glenn Wilson. As Rychek induces a pop fly to right, Benoit makes the catch. Runner tags, but then puts on the brakes. A strong throw from Benoit. So that's out number two. Looks like we'll see a pinch hitter here.
We'll bring up number three, Dane Jones.
For Letourneau, number three, Dane Jones will bat for the Wood.
Senior out of Keller, Texas.
You know, it was from Keller, Texas, was the starting center fielder for the championship 2017 Gents, Zane Wilkinson.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only reason I know that town. Wilkinson, one season with the Gents. Solid defender out there in center.
My dad actually just texted me. He's tuning in and talking about lessons from professional players at one point. I don't know, you probably know the name Calvin Schiraldi.
Don't.
He was one of the pitchers that lost the 76 World Series to the Mets when he was playing with the Red Sox. He was also on the team with who was the first baseman that let the ball go?
Bill Buckner.
Bill Buckner, yeah.
Yep, behind the back, it gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight, and the Mets win at the famous call.
Mm-hmm. That was his team.
Huh.
He never really liked talking about his time in the majors because I think of moments like that. But because I mean, that's what he's, you know, what he was known for, especially because he was a young guy. He was kind of like the Aroldis Chapman when he first stepped on the scene as a as a player in the bigs.
Grounded to short. Boone up with it. On to first. And Aiden Rychek comes in and extinguishes the flames. The Gents right-hander gets a couple of outs and strands a couple of Yellow Jackets on base. Last of the sixth inning coming up next. It's the Gents 6, Yellow Jackets 4. Walker Wicklund leading off the Gents half of the sixth. They're looking for some insurance by two, and pitch misses inside for ball one. This is essentially the bottom of the eighth in this seven-inning ball game. Bottom of the sixth is what the Gents hope to be their last at-bat of this game one. New pitcher on in relief for Letourneau. It's the right-hander Camden Miller. And Devin Grief, by the way, taking over at second base defensively for the pinch hitter. First three pitches miss, and it's three balls and no strikes. Three-0 fastball right there for strike one. Grounded foul into the Yellow Jackets dugout, in and out. Well, if a Gent can reach and stay on base, we might see a Miller versus Miller at bat. Alex Miller for the Gents due up fourth as Camden Miller issues a leadoff walk to Wicklund. And so I think we'll see a pinch runner here.
I'd assume Andrew Landry.
Always got to assume it's Landry, and it is.
For the Gents, number 54, Andrew Landry will run at first base. Left fielder, Carson Livesay.
So the speedy Landry aboard at first, and back to the top of the Gents lineup for Carson Livesay. Miller throws to first, Landry dives back safely.
Caught him leaning a little bit. Landry with two stolen bases on the season, caught stealing once.
Line drive to center, it's a base hit for Livesay. Zarco fields it on a hop, gets the ball back into the infield. Landry over to second. So leadoff walk and a single put a pair of gents on base for Clay Menard.
Third baseman, Clay Menard.
So my question is here, Pierre, does he bunt or do you let Clay swing away?
Let him swing away.
I think he's going to bunt.
I hope he swings away. I know Mike Diaz loves his small ball. And yeah, you're right. There's the bunt. First pitch breaking ball upstairs. Gents already have a two-run lead, and you know it's a non-conference game. I want to see if Menard can get one in the gap, pick up a couple RBIs maybe.
Yeah, we're going to a series like TLU or Trinity next week. I think Coach Diaz may want to see if the guys can play a little bit of small ball and get the job done.
Yeah, good bunt from Menard. He gets the job done there. Play goes sacrifice 2-4 with the new second baseman, Grief, covering the first base bag, and both runners advance for the gents. And here is Miller versus Miller.
First baseman, Alex Miller.
Well, Pierre, you wanted this matchup, and yeah. Now you have it.
Yep. I don't think it'll be quite as good as the Will Smith versus Will Smith.
We're not going to get the matchup.
Oh. This is so sad.
So Miller on with the intentional walk.
Right fielder, Austin Bedwaugh.
Respectfully so. Miller 1-for-2 in this game with a homer to left.
And here's a guy with some pop, Austin Bedwaugh. Already has left the yard at Sheehy Stadium once this season.
And you traded a guy with 5 home runs on the year for a guy with 3 on the year.
First pitch breaking ball over for a strike, a get-me-over slider.
Benoit coming into this game with 27 RBI on the season, 318 average, and a 527 slugging.
Chopper to short on a couple of hops. Head in, fields, and throws to first. Late! RBI infield hit for Austin Benoit. And the gents extend their lead. It's 7-4. So the bases are still full of gents. Just a slowly developing play. The ground ball to short and good hustle down the line from Benoit.
Yeah, after the intentional walk, they got the ground ball that they wanted. Just a little too slow on the infield as that one was chopped really high. Not to mention the runner from second to third, Carson Livesay, did everything he could to try and get as close to that ball as possible and make it hard for the shortstop of the Yellow Jackets to make the play.
A ball and a strike on Boone from the stretch. Here's the pitch. Another breaking ball outside 2-1. Boone reaches and pokes that one out of play. Foul, right side. Two-two. Hit him.
Two at-bats in a row with a hit by pitch for Joby Boone.
Yep, this time he'll pick up an RBI as it'll force home a run. Livesay touches home, and it's 8-4 gents.
Second baseman, Braden Moores.
So that'll bring up Braden Moores. Gents still on every bag. Moores collected an RBI his last time up with a single to center. First pitch, swing and a miss.
Non-typical to see Morse with no batting gloves at the plate. Decided to make that move today during BP.
Interesting. I remember when I started wearing batting gloves in like fourth grade, I want to say, it was just because it was so cold at practice and taking those swings. You know, it was really just that sharp feeling off the bat. Couldn't take it anymore, and so got some batting gloves, and, you know, some people like them, some people don't. I stuck with them the rest of my playing days. You know, you Mr. Gear, you would, you of course.
I actually like the feeling of no batting gloves. The only problem is my hands sweat so much, and with us being in Louisiana,
yeah,
it's a bad combo. That one may drop.
Yeah, it might morse, and it will. So the Gents keep playing station-to-station baseball as Braden Morse picks up another RBI, a single to shallow right. And it's 9-4 Gents.
Center fielder, Colin Pitts.
Well, Braden Morse so far in the day, 3-for-3. So maybe the no batting gloves was the right decision for him today.
So Colin Pitts is going to be pinch hit for as Gents have opened up a 5-run lead.
I believe this is going to be Matthew Herrera, if I'm not mistaken. That's correct. Number 36, Matthew Herrera.
For the Gents, number 36, Matthew Herrera will bat for Pitts.
Sophomore out of Sunnyvale, Texas.
First pitch to Herrera, bends in there for a strike. Nothing and one on the centenary pinch hitter, Matthew Herrera. No relation to Tyler, who pitched earlier in this one. 0-1 delivery. Chopped. Fair ball down the left field line. One run is in. Here comes another. And it's a 2-RBI pinch hit for Matthew Herrera. And the Gents lead 11-4. And looks like we'll have a pinch runner.
Be number 58, Ben Berglund.
For the Gents, number 58, Ben Berglund will run at second base. Catcher, Jay Gons.
I think we may have another batter coming in, potentially. Maybe not for Gaunts, but at least in the on-deck circle for the Gents.
2-run double for Matthew Herrera. Gents lead now by 7. And Lenny Forth, you're right, is in the on-deck circle. Just the one out and still two runners in scoring position. Really nice piece of hitting, by the way, from Herrera. Waited on that pitch and took it to the opposite field. A chopper that was hugging the left field foul line. And it got past the third base bag and into left. So,
and Pierre, if I'm not mistaken, I believe that's his first hit on the season.
Is it?
Yeah, that was his 10th appearance, or 10th at bat on the season, and his first hit. Also his first pair of RBI.
For the Gents, number 21, Julian DeLeon will bat for Gons.
So here's Julian DeLeon batting with 2 on, 1 out, pinch hitting for Gons. First pitch breaking ball, misses outside. 1-0 the count on powerful hitting left-handed hitter Julian DeLeon, graduate of C.E. Byrd and a transfer from LSU Shreveport. And good hitters count now for DeLeon, 2-0 the count.
DeLeon, 4 at-bats on the season, 2 hits, a .500 average.
Served into center as Zarco makes the catch. Runner tags from third. Throw is going to go all the way home, but never going to get Morse at home plate. A sacrifice fly for Julian DeLeon. He picks up a pinch hit RBI, and the Gents lead 12-4.
For the Gents, number 29, Lenny Forth will bat for Winwood.
carousel of changes for the Gents keeps on going. Lenny fourth, pinch hitting for Wigland. And time's going to be called as the Yellow Jackets will meet on the mound. So a new pitcher coming on for Letourneau. We'll step aside, tell you about him when we return from Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport. Gents lead by 8. Jonathan Burton, a right-hander on in relief for Letourneau. Lenny fourth, pinch hitting. Runner at second, two down. From the stretch, the first pitch. Fastball right there for strike one. Berglund at second. 0-1. Pitch at the knees, called strike two. On the pinch hitter, Lenny fourth, sophomore out of Flower Mound, Texas in the Dallas area. Nothing in two, here it is. Low and away. One, two, in the dirt, and it's getting past Vaughn to the backstop. Berglund down to third on the wild pitch. Two, two. upstairs, and the count runs full. And so a balk's going to be called. And a costly one at that for the Yellow Jackets as Berglund comes in to score. And the Gents lead by 9. It's 13-4. Payoff pitch. And that one plunks him. Fourth on at first. And back to the top of the Gents order. Here's Carson Livesay.
Left fielder, Carson Livesay.
First pitch misses high, 1-0. Sharply hit, but foul. Past first base coach Chris Zapata.
Didn't flinch again.
Yeah. Lined into right center. That's going to get down and split the gap. And fourth is going to turn off the afterburners. He's held at third. A two-out double for Livesay. And the Gents, with a couple runners in scoring position, they keep the line moving for Clay Menard.
Third baseman, Clay Menard.
First pitch fastball on the inner edge, strike one. Outside for a ball. Be interesting to see how the Gents configure their defense in the top half of the seventh with all the pinch hitters and pinch runners we've seen this inning.
Imagine we'll probably see someone like McKinley McLaughlin behind the plate, or maybe Caleb Ickes. Who else do we have, Pierre?
Those were the two I had in mind.
New player on the on-deck circle for the Gents.
Grounded to short. We might not get to see him, and we won't. As Hedden throws across to first in time to get Menard. And the inning finally comes to a close. But the Gents open up a 9-run lead as we go to the top of the 7th inning in this 7-inning game 1 of a doubleheader. Last wraps for Letourneau. It's the Gents 13, Yellow Jackets 4. So a brand new battery for the Gents. Zach Godfrey on the mound and Caleb Ickes behind the plate, with Ben Berglund remaining in the game to play center. And a pinch hitter for Letourneau, it's Garrett Irwin, as Godfrey gets him to swing and miss at the next pitch. It's 1-1. Godfrey, a freshman out of Nacogdoches, Texas. The 1-0, or the 1-1, I beg your pardon. That one's swung on and tipped into the mid of Ickes. A ball and two strikes. I wish that's what it would say on the scoreboard, Preston.
Yep. Don't have the luxury sometimes out here.
Up and in, and it's 2-2.
Now we got
it. There we go. 2-2. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. Strikeout number one for Godfrey, and a good start to his outing on the mound.
That'll bring up number 31, Joshua Shannon.
Pinch hitting for Letourneau, number 31, Joshua Shannon.
Pinch hitter for Letourneau.
First pitch from Godfrey misses. Working very quickly, didn't wait for me to finish the pinch hitting announcement for delivering that pitch. Slow roller, it's going to be rolled a foul ball by the home plate umpire. One count on Shannon. Godfrey working from the stretch. Here's the next pitch. Up and in. Rolled a ball, and it's 2-1. Two outs to get for the Gents to claim game one against Letourneau. The next pitch is in on his hands, a soft one hopper to second, and a bang bang play at first, closer than it should have been. Morris able to get the ball to Miller at first in time, however, so Letourneau down to their last out. First pitch strike to another pinch hitter, Landon Edwards. Nothing in one. Swing and a miss. Letourneau down to their final strike. And the dirt blocked by Ickes. 1-2. Right field side, it's out of play. Outside. Godfrey from the stretch, now with the 2-2 in the dirt, and the count runs full, 3 balls and 2 strikes on the pinch hitter, Landon Edwards. Upstairs, ball four. 2-out walk keeps the inning and the game alive for Letourneau, and we'll see another pinch hitter.
Pinch hitting for Letourneau, number 32, Trent Shipman.
Trent Shipman pinch hitting for the Yellow Jackets. 2 down, runner at first. Godfrey keeping the runner close, nothing doing. pitch, fastball up high. 1-0 the count.
I'd imagine you'd probably go back to a slider here. Try and get it over for a strike. He does.
Slow chopper. Off the mound is Godfrey. He fields, sets his feet, throws on to first. And that's a winner for the Diamond Gents. They take game one of this 7-inning doubleheader game day here at Sheehy Stadium. No doubt about that one. 13-4 the final. Centenary is victorious. We'll come back and wrap it up in just a little bit. Final wrap here from Sheehy Stadium, where the Gents win 13-4 in game one of our doubleheader over Letourneau. For the Gents, 13 runs on 10 hits, an error. Their record is now 17-11 on the season. For Letourneau, 4 runs on 5 hits, no errors. They fall to 12-20 on the season. The win goes to Tyler Herrera out of the Gents bullpen. He improves to 2-1. The loss goes to Caden Peoples. He falls to 0-1. Time of the game was 2 hours and 27 minutes. Nice crowd on hand here on a Tuesday afternoon, turning to early evening. And in just a little bit, we'll have game two of our twin bill here at Sheehy Stadium. Another 7-inning game coming your way next. And Preston, I'm looking forward to it. A nice outing in game one for the gents on both ends of the ball.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, good job for Tyler Herrera coming in, and not a conventional spot for him to come into a game. We usually see him as our second game starter during a 3-game series on the weekend. So it was good for him to kind of get in and get some work and build up his confidence on the mound. And then on the other side of the ball, Braden Morris coming off the bench and filling in for Miles Keith and having a 3-for-3 day at the plate. So great job by him, you know, expecting to have his number called and showing out. So great job by the freshman.
Yeah, Gents staff posting zeros after that third inning, and you know, we saw the offense battle back. They lost the lead momentarily there. They were trailing 4-3, and they stormed right back, took a two-run lead, and you know, towards the end of the game, it just got out of hand there. Kind of just hitter after hitter, taking good at-bats, good approaches, and a lot of guys who normally don't get to see in conference got opportunities here in game one. So the Gents win 13-4. We'll have game two coming your way next. From Sheehy Stadium in Shreveport, for Preston Welbrick, this is Pierre Bida saying so long for now.